In this tutorial you're going to learn how to use the train controller asset to add fully functional trains to your Unity project. The train controller asset is available at the Unity Asset Store. Links in the description below. There are timestamps in the video description, so feel free to skip the section if you've already downloaded the asset. To download the asset, go to the Asset Store and search for train controller. For this tutorial, I'm going to use the Ultimate Collection Edition. But everything you will learn on this tutorial also applies to the standard train controller asset as well. The only difference between them is that the Ultimate Collection Edition already includes all add-ins and extension packages. To start the importing process, open the asset page and click the import button. I've already did that before, so I won't have to do it again. Once the asset is installed, all the content will be located under the WSM Game Studio folder. All add-ins and extensions can be found under the add-ins folder. There are also some demo scenes for you to explore and learn more about the asset. The user manual is located under the documentation folder, but you can also access the user manual quickly through the WSM Game Studio menu on the top of the screen. This menu also contains more useful information, such as other assets recommendations and guidelines on how to request support if needed. Add a new railroad on your scene. Right-click on the hierarchy window and go to WSM Game Studio, then Railroad Builder. The Railroad Builder is a spline-based mesh generation tool that allows you to create curved meshes by moving the spline control points around your scene. You can add new curves by clicking on the Add Curve button on the screen, or by holding Shift and right-clicking around your scene. By holding the Control key, you can also select and edit multiple control points at the same time. To apply the changes made to your railroad, click the Generate Mesh button on the screen. This button is also available in the Inspector under the Mesh Operations section. By default, whenever you click on a control point, the camera will zoom at that control point location. The zoom settings can be changed under the Scene View tab of the Spline component. If you zoom at the start or the end of your railroad, you'll notice that there are railroad stop blocks on each side. The stop blocks are added by default, but they can be removed by unchecking the start and end cap properties. To remove curves from the end of your railroad, click the Remove Curve button on the screen. You can also remove control points from the middle of the railroad by using the Dissolve Curve operation. Or, you can add more control points by using the Subdivide Curve operation. Now let's move to the top view, so we can take a closer look at the curve shaping operations. When using the Shift key to create a new curve, both length and curvature will be calculated automatically based on the mouse cursor position. The curve generation algorithm will always try to generate a perfect circular curve towards the direction the last curve is pointing to. If you need mathematical precision for both length and curvature, you can use the Quick Building Access menu, located on the top left corner of the screen. By using both features, you can quickly build your railroad while maintaining full control of the curves. Now let's take a look at some useful spline operations that can also be used to edit your railroad. The Split operation divides one railroad into two. It uses the selected control point as reference for the cutting process, so it is only available when a control point is selected. The merge operation works the other way around, by joining two railroads into one. When using this operation, you can choose between deleting or keeping the second railroad as a disabled object in your scene. The connect target operation moves the target object to the end of the currently selected railroad. It is useful for connecting rail segments to each other. The bridge gap operation creates a new curve to close the gap between the end of the current railroad and the start of the next one. The append operation creates a brand new railroad connected at the end of the current one. The flatten operation moves all the control points along the selected axis to create a flat spline. For example, by flattening along the y-axis, you can reset the heights of all control points to create a perfectly flat railroad. Reset normals operation resets all normals along the spline. The normals are edited by using the Unity Editor rotation handle to create a bended rails effect. The reset spline operation resets the railroad to its initial state, which is a single straight rail segment. The create parallel operation creates another railroad perfectly parallel to the current selected one. It is useful for creating double track railways. And finally, the revert spline operation. It reverts the control point's direction and moves the railroad pivot location while maintaining the railroad shape intact on your scene. Now let's take a look on how to create a railroad embankment using the new terrain features. Before making any changes to your terrain, it is important to make a backup, just to be safe. The backup terrains feature creates a copy of the terrain data to save your terrain current state. It is not recommended to rename, delete, or move the backup files to another folder to avoid losing the backup data. We can use the backup data to revert any changes made to the terrain by using the restore terrains operation. To create a railroad embankment, first, move your railroad up in the y-axis until it matches the desired height. In this example, I'll move it up 1 meter above the terrain. Now select the terrain texture you wish to apply along the railroad embankment. In order for this texture to be applied successfully, your terrain must have a corresponding layer with the same texture applied to the diffuse channel. It is possible to customize the embankment curvature if you wish, but for this example, I'll just use the default curve. When you click on the terraforming button, a warning will pop up, just to make sure you've remembered to backup your terrain. My backup is up to date, so I'll click on proceed. Now we just have to wait for the terraforming feature to finish its magic. I'm really pleased with the results, but depending on your terrain settings, you may need to adjust the terraforming settings to achieve a better result on your scene. If the results are not satisfactory, you can use the Restore Terrain feature, adjust the settings and try again. Now let's talk about railroad limitations and good practices to improve performance. Unity has a limit of roughly 65,000 vertices per mesh. It is important to respect this limit for performance sake and to make sure the generated meshes will be compatible with all platforms. For this reason, it is necessary to use multiple railroads connected to each other whenever you need to build very long railroads. When the auto split feature is enabled, the railroad will be splitted automatically during mesh generation to avoid reaching this limit. The following message will also be logged in the Unity Editor console, just to let you know that auto split was triggered. If you want more control over the railroad splitting process, disable this option and use the manual split operation instead. Once you've finished editing your railroad, you can bake it into a static railroad prefab to optimize the performance of your scene. To open the Mesh Baker window, go to WSN Game Studio, Train Controller, Utilities, Mesh Baker. It can also be opened by clicking the Bake Mesh button in the inspector. The baking process is pretty straightforward. Just select a name and a target folder to save your prefab and click bake. The railroad builder on your scene will be disabled and replaced by the bake prefab by default. If you don't want this to happen, change the baking behavior to just export. If you're planning on using spline-based trains, you must leave the save spline option enabled. This is not mandatory for physics-based trains, but heavily recommended. Now that you know the basics of the railroad builder, it is time to build your first railroad. For this example, I'll use the quick access building menu to create a simple railroad loop. Since I'm using a single railroad builder, I will enable the closed loop property to merge the first and last control points. I will also use the create parallel operation to duplicate the tracks and make it a double track railway. As you can see, it only takes a few minutes to create a simple railroad like this. The railroad builder is both powerful and easy to use. making it one of the most user-friendly railroad solutions for Unity 3D. Starting with version 3.4, the train controller asset now supports both physics-based trains and spline-based trains. For more details on the pros and cons of each type of train, please refer to the user manual. For now, let's add a spline-based train to our railroad, just for demonstration purposes. The easiest way to add trains to your scene is by using the train spawner. Right-click on the hierarchy window and go to WSM Game Studio. Train spawner. In order to use the train spawner, first we need to define some routes. So, let's also add a route manager to the scene. Now let's use the route manager to create a route for each railroad on our scene. For demonstration purposes, let's add a freight train on route number 1 and a steam train on route number 2. Take a closer look at the trains. I'll also add a simple camera follow script before hitting play. The direction of a spline-based train depends on the railroad spline direction. If you enable Visualize Route on Inspector, you will be able to see the current route applied to your train. The direction of the railroad can be reverted by using the Revert Spline operation. To apply any changes made on the route to your trains, just use the Move to Start Position operation. The Route Manager can also be used to move trains to another route. By using the assign route operation. This operation makes sure your trains are not stuck to the route they were spawned on. If you manually drop a train prefab on your scene, this operation can also be used to move it to the desired starting position on your railroad. This technique serves as an alternative way to add trains on your scene without using the train spawner. Now let's take a look on how to add a railroad switch, also known as turnout. I'll start by cutting a section of both railroads to clear the way for the turnout. Before baking the rails, I'll change the mesh generation profile to physics-based, just to make sure the turnout will be compatible with both types of trains. If you're using only spline-based trains on your project, this is optional. To create a turnout between these railroads, I'll need to bake rail segments that fill the gap between the rails. First, I'll bake a straight rail segment. This segment will be used for both parallel rails. I'll also need to create a curved rail segment. This segment will be used for the rails transition. Now I'll drop the baked rail segments to the scene and rename them to make them easier to identify. I'll also duplicate the straight rail segment and move it to the right to close the parallel rails gap. The rails are in position, but in order to work properly, they need to be converted into a turnout prefab. I'll open the turnout creator window on WSM Game Studio, Train Controller, Utilities, Railroad Turnout Creator. Creating a turnout prefab is pretty straightforward. Just select the rails, a name, and click on Create. The selected rails will be replaced by an instance of the newly created turnout by default. The turnout prefab will be saved on the target folder and can be reused as many times as you wish. Physics-based railroad switching is pretty simple. It works by enabling and disabling the rails guide colliders, and the train will follow whichever direction is selected. On the other hand, spline-based railroad switching is a bit more complex and depends on the route manager to work properly. For this reason, I'll be covering spline-based railroad switching in this tutorial. Before setting up the routes affected by this turnout, let's update the route manager to reflect the changes made on the railroad. Since I've cutted the railroads, I'll have to update the existing routes to make sure they cover the entire loop. In order to do that, I'll have to complete the routes using the turnout rail segment splines. I'll also add a transition route. This route will be used to change the train direction when the turnout is activated. Note that the splines before and after the turnout also needs to be added on the transition route. These splines will act as a buffer for the wagons during the rails transition. The routes are now up to date. So I can select which routes are affected by this turnout under the spline base tab. Pay attention to the index being assigned to each selected route. It will be used later to set up the switch triggers. In this example, I'll use switch triggers owns to activate the turnout automatically. Before setting up the trigger, I'll move it so it is located on top of the rails, right before the turnout junction. Then, I'll set a reference to the target turnout under the General Settings tab. Under the Spline Base Settings tab, you will notice the trigger will recognize the target turnout and show which routes are currently configured as left and right routes. The first trigger will move the train from the current route to the transition route. I'll also use a second trigger to make sure the train will leave the transition route once the route switching process is complete. For a perfect seamless transition, it is important that there is enough space between the turnout and the second trigger, so that all the wagons have already left the turnout before activation. Before hitting play, I'll use the assign route operation to apply the changes made on the current route to the train. The route switching process can be tested in the scene view by enabling Visualize Route on Editor. When this option is enabled, you'll be able to visualize the current route applied to the train. As you can see, the route changes automatically when the train passes through the switch trigger zone. Besides using switch triggers, turnouts can also be activated by invoking the switch rails public method, allowing integration with third-party or custom scripts. Trains are automated by default. But, you can change train settings like max speed, acceleration rate and direction, under the train controls section. Railroad control zones can also be used to trigger events automatically when the train passes through them. The effect of each control zone is pretty much self-explanatory. For example, the station stop zone is used to simulate train stations. Besides the default control zones, there are also custom event zones that allows you to trigger unity events on your scene, including public methods, from third-party or custom scripts. You can also control your train using the keyboard by enabling the train player input property on your locomotive. The keys configurations are defined by the default train input settings. These settings can be customized, but it is also possible to create multiple custom input settings for your project. In-game wagon coupling is enabled by default. The coupling settings can be changed on the wagon component. Wagons will connect automatically when the couplers touch each other. It is also possible to decouple wagons in-game. Spline-based wagons will retain the decoupling position after being disconnected. On the other hand, physics-based wagons will be affected by inertia if disconnected at higher speeds. Well, this pretty much covers the main features available in the asset. If you have any questions, feel free to post them in the comment section below. Also, don't forget to check out the asset store links in the video description. The next tutorial will be specifically about the customization features. I'll see you there.